The main lines of the United Kingdom are the arteries of rail transport across its nations, with trains pulsing to and from the mighty heart of London. Vital to the economy, it is little wonder that early pioneers of the railways sought to seize upon the promise of lucrative financial returns that would come from connecting to the capital. Yet, although the main lines we know today seem to be part of the landscape, it is fair to say that some have become lost to it. This is the story of one such line. Opened in 1857 by the Midland Railway as part of its new main line from Leicester to London via Hitchin, the Bedford to Hitchin line would give the company the access it sought to what is now the East Coast Main Line and a route into London and King's Cross. However, the route into London was reliant upon their rival company, the Great Northern Railway, here illustrated in orange, allowing the Midland to use their rails between Hitchin and King's Cross. In 1862, the Great Northern evicted the Midland from its London terminus, obliging them to seek an alternative route into the capital. Thus, the Midland constructed today's Midland Main Line from Bedford to London St Pancras. In so doing, the Bedford to Hitchin line was downgraded from a main line to a branch line. Passenger operations on this railway ceased in 1961, and the transportation of goods in 1964. And so we begin in Bedford. This fine photograph of the former Midland Road station is made all the more poignant by the fact that no trace of the station remains. Suffering bomb damage during the war, the old station was demolished, with the new architecturally unappealing building being erected north of the old site by 100 metres. Trains for Hitchin would depart beneath Ford End Road Bridge and pass through what is now a large set of sidings. Notice the former goods shed to the right of the picture. Heading south, trains would cross the River Great Ouse. And pass beneath Ampthill Road Bridge, where a car park now occupies the trackbed. Beyond the gates lies the Marston Vale line, which the railway crossed on the level. On the southeastern outskirts of Bedford, Meadowsweet Drive has been built on the trackbed. Leaving the town behind now, the railway becomes positively rural in character. Though it is time-worn, this bridge crossing the stream is delightful. We continue south. The railway's course is clearly marked by the tree line and the embankment. On Harrowden Lane, however, all traces of the railway have been swept away by housing. But if we refer to footage taken by this channel in 2015, we can see that there are some relics of the railway still to be found. We return to the present day and prepare to call at our next stop. Opened in 1857, Cardington's life was relatively quiet, save for the war years when the station helped to serve the nearby RAF Cardington. The station is now a private residence. Departing Cardington, one quickly encounters a famous local landmark. Cardington Airship Sheds. Indeed, originally built to serve the development of airships after the First World War, the hangars have had a varied afterlife, but the presence of these magnificent structures can also be directly connected to the railway. Cardington Workmen's Platform was opened in 1917, just north of Southill Road Bridge. It is speculated that the halt's unusual name probably derives itself from the passenger demographic, chiefly those working on the construction of airships at the nearby hangars. Standing in its approximate location, the halt survived only a few years into peacetime, closing in 1921. Having passed beneath Southill Road Bridge, trains would continue onwards. Facing north, one can see Bedford and how the railway's southward journey is marked by the trees. Whereupon it enters this deep cutting. Here, one encounters the railway's most significant structure, Old Warden Tunnel. Built of blue engineering bricks, the tunnel is ovoid in shape and 882 yards in length. Even within the tunnel's gloomy interior, glamour can still be found, since both it and the preceding stretch of line made a brief appearance in the 1965 film comedy Those Magnificent Men in Their Flying Machines. We now view the waterlogged trackbed south of the tunnel. And here, this stately road bridge close to Warden Abbey. Trains would travel a further mile before reaching the next station. Located at a reasonable distance from the tiny village which gives it its name, Southill Station probably owes its existence to the Whitbread family of nearby Southill Park, whose influence partly saw to it that the line came to be constructed at all. Today, this is as close as one can get to the station building, which lives on as a private residence. Departing Southill, trains would cross this bridge. When the line became a single-track railway in 1911, the portion between Southill and Shefford was the only section to retain its double-track status. Only recently, bridge abutments here on Bedford Road were demolished. Once again, footage taken by the channel reveals their presence in 2015. Now on the outskirts of Shefford, one encounters this bridge which has survived demolition. And on top of the bridge, railway sleepers from the line. The railway entered Shefford on an embankment upon which we now stand. Nearly 10 miles from Bedford Midland Road, there is little evidence of the railway's presence in the town today. Unlike other stations on the line, the station building was constructed of wood. This was later demolished and replaced by a concrete structure at road level. This is the station's approximate site. It was situated atop a bridge which ran through the town. Both station and bridge have long since been demolished, but are commemorated by this public house which abutted the structure. The railway continued south in this direction. Here is the northward view of the railway from Chapel Road Bridge. The view south, where trains would travel a little over a mile to their penultimate stop. Opened along with the rest of the line in 1857 as Henlow, the station saw little by way of passenger traffic. However, the establishment of RAF Henlow at the end of the First World War saw this increase. To reflect the military footfall at the station, it was renamed Henlow Camp in 1933. Approximately the same view today. All traces of the station and railway have disappeared. We now journey south along the trackbed. Having left Henlow, the railway made its way through open fields. Gone now is the cutting which trains entered at this point. As has the bridge under which they passed, though its presence has been commemorated. Between here and Ickleford, on the outskirts of Hitchin, there's little to suggest the railway's presence. Indeed, much of the railway embankment which ran through Ickleford has been levelled, though portions such as this remain. The north abutment of this bridge is one of the railway's few survivors in the village. We stand now on the overgrown embankment. As before, the tree line marks the railway's route as it closed in on Hitchin. And so the line from Bedford joined what is now the East Coast Main Line, just beneath the Hitchin flyover, itself completed in 2013. It was then just under a mile to the final stop. Opened on the 7th of August 1850, Hitchin is 31 miles and 71 chains from London King's Cross. As a main line, the Bedford to Hitchin Railway saw only a decade of use before eking out its living as a branch line for the remainder of its life. One can only speculate how the towns and villages along its route might have looked today had the railway survived. But here, facing Hitchin Station from the south, we reach our journey's end. I hope you enjoyed this film. Please subscribe, share, and watch Rediscovering Lost Railways.